Good afternoon, friends. I welcome you all for a live teleconferencing session for the subject of surgery. Dear students, as you all know that this teleconferencing session is brought to you jointly by National Board of Examinations and Indira Gandhi National Open University. We are coming to you live from the studios of the Indira Gandhi National Open University. Students, this month we were concentrating on the basic sciences in relation to various specialties, because we feel that this part of the subject is neglected by many students because of the fear of the basic sciences. So today we are going to concentrate on basic sciences in respect to the surgery field. Before I go on, I'd like to welcome all my guests who have come all the way from Rohtak. And to my left side is Dr. Pradeep Garg, who is a professor of surgery from PGIMS Rohtak. On my right side is Dr. Satish Dalal. He is an associate professor of surgery, also from PGI Rohtak. And on my extreme right is Dr. Vishal. He is also from PGI Rohtak. So, on the behalf of National Board of Examinations, I welcome you all for this live teleconferencing session. Students, let me tell you about the topics for today. The first topic would be applied surgery of the head, neck and face. The second topic would be applied anatomy of the breast and the intestine. The third topic would be applied surgery of the anus and the rectum. The fourth session would be applied surgery of prostate and testes. And the last and the final session would be on applied surgery of liver and varicose veins. So dear friends, please tell all your friends to join in for this live teleconferencing session. And I expect all my students, please attend these sessions, because these sessions are for you. You can clear all your doubts, all your queries, and you can always call us anytime during this session. The phone numbers of the INU studio are 011, that's the STD code, 2953-2844, 011-2953-2845. You can also fax in your queries. The fax number is 011-2953-6134. And in case you want to call through the toll-free number is 1-800-112345. These lines are open. You can call us anytime. Our experts are here to answer your queries. So without any further delay, I'd like to invite Dr. Pradeep Garg to give his first talk on applied surgery of the head, face and neck. Dr. Pradeep, sir, please.
Good afternoon, my dear residents. As Dr. Pankaj has already introduced, you studied anatomy way back during first year, and you are not aware about the importance of the applied aspect, largely because neither you saw patients, diseases, even operations. Now, after doing graduation, when you choose surgery as a field of your career, applied anatomy becomes a very, very important thing, because this forms the very skeleton of the surgical sites. Applied anatomy is very important because this forms the basis of physical tests, certain operations, and day in and day out, whatever you do in surgery, this applied anatomy is always at your hand. We have chosen certain important areas which a general surgeon deals from virtually on daily basis. To start with the scalp, as you see, it consists of five layers, that is S for skin, C for connective tissue, A for aponeurosis, L for loose connective tissue, and P for pericranium. These five layers, S, C, A, L, P, constitute a scalp. Right? This diagram is here. This is the loose areolar tissue, which is of importance to us. and this is the dense connective tissue which is of importance to us, and just above the pericranium this loose connective tissue is of importance to us. How it is important? Skin has greater number of sebaceous glands, hence scalp is the commonest site of sebaceous cysts. You must have also seen that slightest of wound in the scalp leads to profuse bleeding. The reason is that these vessels are lying, they are firmly anchored by dense connective tissue, preventing retraction of the vessels. Since these vessels cannot close, the patient keeps on bleeding profusely. Third important aspect which is surgically important is the loose areolar tissue or subaponeurotic space. This is also called as dangerous area of scalp because emissary veins are present in this and they communicate with the intradural space. Now coming on to the surgical aspects of anatomy of face. See, this is anterior facial vein which communicates with cavernous sinus through ophthalmic veins and deep facial vein. Deep facial vein which connects pterygoid plexus lying in relation to external pterygoid muscle. Now what is the importance of this? This anterior facial vein has no walls. It lies amongst the muscles which by contraction may displace clot, and you know your facial muscles are in contraction all the times except during sleep. Third important aspect of anterior facial vein is that it drains danger area of face, that is upper lip, septum of nose and adjoining area. And since there is no deep fascia in the face to act as barrier to spread of inflammation, the infective process has from the skin, the infective process from the skin has direct access to the underlying muscles. Now what is danger area of face? Boils and infections of face occur very commonly here. In fact the diagram is not coming at the moment here, and it deserves greatest respect from the surgeon as the infection may spread along these valveless veins connecting cavernous sinus. This is the danger in the face. You know, the diagram has come. This is the danger area of face, right? So if you come across any surgical problem like carbuncle or any injury, if it is infected, it's likely to cause catastrophe by spreading into right cavernous sinus. So you have to be very, very gentle while dealing with these. Now coming on to the facial nerve, the surgical aspects. The facial nerve has a very important relation with the parotid. In the parotid gland, the nerve lies superficial to the posterior facial vein. And as this is emerging out, it divides into a temporofacial trunk. This is temporofacial trunk, which turns almost at 90s, and then gives temporal branch and zygomatic branch. The second is cervicofacial trunk. This is the cervicofacial trunk, which runs the natural course of the main trunk, and then gives three branches, that is buccal, marginal mandibular or mandibular, and cervical branch. What is the surgical importance of this nerve? Of course, all the branches are important, but we must know specifically about mandibular branch. I am talking about this branch. Now, mandibular branch passes just below angle of mandible. You can again see here is the angle of mandible, and passes below the angle of mandible, and then lies deep to platysma, between platysma and the deep cervical fascia. And then it turns up and crosses the lower border of mandible to supply quadratus labii inferioris muscle. Any incision behind angle of mandible, angle of jaw, that is between mastoid process to hyoid bone, will eventually cut this branch, causing temporary paralysis and asymmetry of the mouth. Hence, instead of choosing incision at this side, the incision must be made at least 1 inch behind the angle. A word about facial vein, because this commonly comes across while doing parotid dissections. As I said earlier, the nerve is anterior and the vein is posterior, right? Now, this facial vein, posterior facial vein, is formed by the union of superficial temporal vein and middle temporal vein. This facial, posterior facial vein, the facial trunk is in front of it, running all the five branches in front of it. The posterior facial vein divides into a posterior branch and an anterior branch or a tributary. The anterior tributary and anterior facial, they join to form common facial vein, whereas the posterior tributary and posterior auricular vein, they join to form external jugular vein. This is external jugular vein. Now, coming on to the, so that's important aspects about face and scalp. Now, coming on to the thyroid, an average surgeon has to face thyroid very commonly, various diseases of thyroid, and we must know its anatomy thoroughly. Thyroid has two lateral lobes connected by isthmus. The lateral lobes are 2 inches long, 1 inch in width and 1 inch in thickness. Isthmus is 1.5 inch long and it is 1/2 inch broad. The lateral lobes, they extend from middle of side of the thyroid cartilage to 6th tracheal ring, whereas the isthmus, it lies on 2nd, 3rd and 4th tracheal ring. Now, this is very important. In emergency, every resident has to do tracheostomy. You must have done several tracheostomies, must be aware about this anatomy, otherwise you might injure the isthmus, inviting unnecessary bleeding in the operative field. The medial surface of the thyroid lobe is related to, very simple to remember, two tubes, two nerves and two muscles. Two tubes, that is esophagus and trachea, two nerves, that is recurrent laryngeal nerve and external laryngeal nerve, two muscles, that is inferior constrictor and cricothyroid muscle. The posterior surface of the thyroid lobe overlaps the common carotid artery. This is very important, because while going on posterior aspect, you may not inadvertently injure the carotid artery. As far as the arterial supply is concerned, the thyroids are supplied by two arteries, that is superior and inferior thyroid arteries. Superior thyroid artery arises from external carotid and lies superomedially and easily exposed, because it is almost superficial, I'll say. Inferior thyroid artery, it arises from thyrocervical trunk, and thyrocervical trunk is a branch of subclavian artery. This inferior thyroid artery, it lies in posterior relation of gland, and hence it is exposed with difficulty. You can imagine subclavian artery giving branch to thyrocervical, which again giving branch as inferior thyroid. It must be lying sufficiently deep and difficult to expose. Veins of the thyroid do not accompany the artery. Superior thyroid vein drains in lateral, in internal jugular vein, and this vein, superior thyroid vein, it leaves upper pole of the gland. Whereas the middle thyroid vein, it also drains into internal jugular vein and it leaves the gland almost in the middle of the lobe. Now, important aspects about middle thyroid vein is that it is a short vein. It bleeds profusely if torn, so it should be ligated doubly. The last vein is inferior thyroid vein. Important, while the superior thyroid vein left the upper pole, middle thyroid left the middle part of the lobe, the inferior thyroid vein, it leaves the isthmus at its lower border and it runs down in front of trachea and ends in innominate vein. Importance of inferior thyroid vein is, this is relatively large size vein, and this is the vein which is cut at the end of operation after arteries are dealt. Because if you do it other way round, if you tie the vein first and arteries are not ligated, the venous congestion of the gland will occur and will cause lot of problem in dissection, and of course bleeding will take place. Now, as far as nerves of the thyroid are concerned, they are two, that is external and recurrent laryngeal nerve. About external laryngeal nerve, it's a branch of superior laryngeal nerve supplying cricothyroid muscle. And this external laryngeal nerve, it lies close to superior thyroid vessels at superior pole. And the relationship from lateral to medial side is like this, that most lateral is superior thyroid vein, then is superior thyroid artery, and most medial is the external laryngeal nerve. And this nerve lies outside the false capsule, so it can be easily separated, it can be easily saved, one can even see during dissection. So injury to the nerve can be avoided by ligating superior thyroid vessels on thyroid gland itself, just below the superior pole. Call it as near to the superior pole as possible, or virtually on superior pole if it is not malignant process. Its injury causes hoarseness of the voice. Now, about recurrent laryngeal nerve, it lies in the tracheoesophageal groove, embedded, and it is in half the cases, is a very significant number, in 50% cases it is buried, embedded in Barry's ligament. And during dissection, when the thyroid lobe is pulled up, Barry's ligament is also pulled up, and the nerve is drawn and is likely to be injured, right? Say for example, in this diagram, this is the vagus nerve, this is recurrent laryngeal nerve, this is external laryngeal nerve, this is superior thyroid artery. And if you see this diagram, this is normal location of recurrent laryngeal nerve. And if you see this diagram, it is buried in the Barry's ligament, and when the lobe has been pulled forward, it has tented here. And when you are dissecting somewhere here, it is likely to be injured. Now, a word about the difference in pattern of inoculation in thyroid and prostate. I thought it proper to highlight at this time only, because you see both the glands, this is the prostate, it has a true capsule and a false capsule, and between true and false capsule you have venous plexus. Similarly in thyroid, this is false capsule, this is true capsule, and the arteries are penetrating the true capsule, and then they supply the gland. Plane of inoculation, when you take out the adenoma, you go inside the true capsule like this. This dotted line shows the plane of inoculation, means when you take out the adenoma in prostate, true and false capsule both are intact. Whereas after ligating the arteries in thyroid, you go deep to, you go in between the true and false capsule, means after inoculating or after taking out the thyroid lobe, false capsule remains out. So that's the difference. Now coming on to parathyroids. In fact, the total number of parathyroid in any person can be 2 to 6. In 80%, they are actually 4 in number, and there are 2 on each side. About 20% population has 6 parathyroids. Total weight of all 4 glands is not more than 140 milligram. Upper parathyroids lie in close association with upper part of lateral lobe of thyroid. And this upper parathyroid is fairly constant in position. It arises from the fourth branchial pouch. As far as the lower parathyroids are concerned, they arise from third branchial pouch in association with thymus, and actually descends with the thymus. Descent of thymus and inferior parathyroid is almost together. Now, because of embryological migration, the inferior thyroid may be located anywhere from upper pole of thymus to anterior mediastinum. So to remember, the upper parathyroid is almost constant in position, inferior parathyroid you have to search down from the line which I have said. A word about its arterial supply. The upper parathyroid artery is supplied from inferior thyroid, as also the lower parathyroid. But the parathyroid receives good collateral supply from tracheal vessels. Hence, even if you tie the inferior parathyroid, the functions of parathyroid will persist. However, this is little lighter, but I'll just read it out. However, it is possible and desirable also to save the artery going to parathyroid and then tie the inferior thyroid trunk by a meticulous dissection. So the modern trend is that try to save the arterial supply of the parathyroid gland. Now we come to the most important aspect of neck, that is cervical lymph nodes. Now the distribution of cervical lymph nodes is like this. They are dispensed in 7 levels. Now we call them levels of lymph node, and they are dispensed in 7 levels. 4 levels are present in anterior triangle of the neck, anterior triangle between midline and this esternomastoid, and this is the lower border of the mandible, level 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, 4. So level from 1 to 4 they are lying in the anterior triangle. One level, that is level 5, is lying in the posterior triangle, and two levels, they lie in the center of neck. I'll tell you what is center of neck. Now in anterior triangle, as I said, there are 4 levels. Level 1, that is this one, it consists of submental and submandibular lymph nodes. Level 2 is upper jugular chain, that is jugulodigastric group of lymph nodes. Level 3 is middle jugular chain, and level 4 is lower jugular chain. So these are the 4 groups of anterior triangle. A posterior triangle has only one level, that is level 5. All the lymph nodes in posterior triangle are grouped together as level 5 lymph nodes. Now coming on to the lymph nodes level in the center of neck. For all practical purposes, we consider center of neck as a space between lateral border of both sides. Lateral border of ribbon muscle of one side to the lateral border of ribbon muscle of the other side. The space in between is called as a central space. The lymph nodes which are present superior to supraesternal notch and medial to lateral extent of strip muscles bilaterally. Superior to supraesternal notch, it is level 6. And below that is level 7. They are also called as paratracheal lymph nodes, that is inferior to supraesternal notch, and they are virtually present in upper mediastinum.